or there will be trouble.
Of course, machines can't think as people do. A machine is different.
Thank you all for staying for the Q&A portion of this. I'm going to introduce our speakers, and then we're just going to go ahead and open it up to questions, because I'm sure you guys have a lot of questions and a lot of things to kind of process about the film. First, I'd like to introduce Dr. Jeremy White. Jeremy is a biology instructor at the University of Nebraska at Omaha, and his work is focused on ecology and conservation, and his research deals with the behavior, ecology, and natural history of mammals. Dr. White grew up in Nevada, where he obtained his biology degree at the University of Nevada in Las Vegas, and this is my favorite part of his bio. He worked as a wildland firefighter before returning for his master's degree at UNO, and then went on to earn his PhD at Auburn University in Alabama before returning to UNO to teach 8 years ago. He teaches courses in general biology, environmental biology, and the fauna of the Great Plains. His past research includes studies on the behavior of seed-storing rodents and their role in plant dispersal in the Great Plains, but his current research is focused on the distribution and natural history of bats in the United States. Specifically, and this is kind of what put us in touch with, I think, Dr. White originally, he's studying the northern myotis, which was just listed last year in the United States as a threatened species, and it's a species that occurs naturally in Nebraska. He is studying the seasonality and movement patterns in conjunction with the effects of white nose syndrome and the effects of wind power on migratory animals. So we have been super lucky to work with Jeremy on and his students on bat surveys in the past, and he is also serving as Nebraska Wildlife's High School Science Academy professor this month in April. Joel Sartore is a photographer, speaker, author, teacher, conservationist, National Geographic Fellow, and a regular contributor to National Geographic Magazine. Joel specializes in documenting endangered species and landscapes in order to show a world worth saving. He is the founder of PhotoArc, a multi-year documentary project to save species and habitat. Joel has written several books, including Rare, Portraits of America's Endangered Species, Photographing Your Family, and Nebraska Under a Big Red Sky. His most recent book is Let's Be Reasonable. Is that the most recent one?
Sure.
Yeah, there might be one after that. All right. In addition to this work, the work he has done for National Geographic, he has contributed to Audubon, Time, Life, Newsweek, Sports Illustrated, and numerous book projects. His work has been the subject of several national broadcasts, including National Geographic's Explorer, the NBC Nightly News, NPR's Weekend Edition, and an hour-long PBS documentary at Close Range. He is also a regular contributor on the CBS Morning Show with Charles Osgood. Joel graduated from the University of Nebraska with a degree in journalism, and he currently lives in Lincoln with his wife and three children. We've known Joel for many years, 6 or 8 years. He has taken many photos of the wildlife of Nebraska that we have in rehab, and so many of those animals are included in PhotoArc, which if you stop by our table, you'll see them out in the hallway. Most recently, a photo he took of one of our albino porcupines was all over National Geographic in an amazing way, so that was very exciting for us. So, those are the bios. I'd like to open it up for questions if anybody's ready. If not yet, then how about we do this? Jeremy, first impressions from the film.
Thoughts, okay. Important film, I think. And mentioned early on, I think this should be the front page news. This is something we need to think about. It's something we need to be aware of and we need to talk about. And I think they did a good job in conveying, you know, the variety of ways we're doing damage to species and causing extinctions in this loss of biodiversity, but also solutions and things we can do to change this. And if there's a NASCAR driver who's an environmental activist, then I think we can rewrite some rules, you know, and do some things.
That film's pretty depressing, isn't it? A lot of it. Well, you know, I photograph a lot of species that are going to be extinct, and I don't get depressed about it really, because I'm pretty convinced that nature doesn't need us. We really need nature. Nature will thrive after people are gone. You know, we'll blow ourselves up or do something, you know, whatever we're going to do to each other. But I think about a cornfield that I bought years ago that had a breached little dam on it that held a pond at one time. And cornfields are pretty toxic places. You know, we slather the landscape with this concoction to kill insects and plants we don't want. We call them weeds. And so it was a pretty toxic place. There's nothing growing. It was just this kind of mud puddle that it had a little bit of mud in the bottom of it. But we fixed the dam, and we went back about 4 to 6 weeks after we'd had enough rain to fill this pond up. And I mean, there's no water for a mile around there. No water anywhere. And we came over the hill, and we saw swallows buzzing the top of the water for insects, for mosquitoes. We saw dragonflies doing the same thing. We saw egrets taking off. They were feeding on the frogs and the tadpoles that were all inhabiting this thing. There was no water for a mile. There were turtles everywhere. And then in the center, there were clouds of bullhead catfish, babies, just clouds of them, that must have survived as eggs in the mud. And this was, I don't know, we just added water into a toxic cornfield, and it just came roaring back. So the oceans will come roaring back. Everything will come roaring back when we take the pressure off of it. Even if the oceans are acidified, there will be, in my opinion, there will be animals that thrive in acidic water. But the problem for all of us is it's going to change the atmosphere so much that we won't get rain where we need it to grow crops, and millions of people will starve to death, the poorest ones first, right? That's a huge problem. We won't be able to live as comfortably or as thoughtlessly as we do. And so the photo arc is really a gimmick to get people into the tent of conservation and care about how we all live before everything's gone. Every animal's an opportunity to get people to start thinking about how we live. I spoke at a grade school today twice for my nephew, who asked me to do it since I was in town. And I noticed that all the parents waiting to pick these kids up, and they have a pretty good environmental education plan in place at this school. Not all, I'd say 90%. We're driving SUVs, sitting by themselves in the cars. It was a beautiful day today. They had their windows up and the cars running, and they were running the air conditioning. All of them, 100 cars, SUVs as far as you can see. So people aren't even aware. They're not even aware. Our job is to make people aware. You guys have seen this movie, and sad as it is, it can kind of serve as a wake-up call to you guys. Don't think about saving the entire world. Just think about saving a piece of it. Concentrate on one thing and make a change that way. That's what I would suggest.
Hi, thanks for being here. I know that you're affiliated with UNO, not UNL, and I'm not sure if there was a parallel effort, but I remember reading not very long ago in the paper that an attempt was made by somebody at UNL to have the cafeteria have one meatless day a week, something that was promoted in the movie and looks like one of those easy one thing you can do. And it got, I think, shot down by the powers that be in the university. And I wondered if you have any update on that. Is there anything parallel to that that UNO is doing? Is there something that we as taxpayers can do to encourage that kind of behavior at the university level?
So there's not, I'm not aware of the movement at UNL, but UNO, it's not official university run, but there's a group that's asking people to do that, students to do that, faculty to do that on their own, to take Meatless Monday, they call it. So on Mondays, today, right? He said, don't, you know, just one day a week, as it suggested there, which makes a huge difference if you don't eat meat just one day a week or dairy products. So, and I think one of the things as Joel said, is we need to talk about this. We need to tell other people about this and try and start something.
Yeah, you know, I went to the climate change summit in Paris, and the whole theme wasn't about saving endangered species or habitats that help regulate our climate and all that. It was just about how can we not cook ourselves so we can still grow the economy as fast as we possibly can. That's, you know, I think true change is generational. I used to get very impatient with my editor at the Geographic that I wanted these stories we did to really change the world right this second. And he says, you know, it takes 20 or 30 years. And we've only been talking about climate change the last 4 or 5 years in terms of a public appeal. And a lot of people still don't buy it. And so that'll change as the earth gets weirder and weirder. People are going to have to look at, I mean, farmers are the first to see what's happening on the land because they are so tied to it. People that hunt and fish as well, and bird. But it's something that'll happen. It's just a bit of a race to see how much life survives this bottleneck we're going into as we reach 10 or 11 billion people, you know. But there's no cause to get too down about it. It's just, what are you going to do about it? What can you do to change things for the better, just in your own little way? What can you work on? What's the one thing you can work on? That's the one message at the back end of the film, isn't it?
So my question is, on the heels of this, Joel, is that I think as adults we can get creative and figure out ways that we can be you know, a little less gas hungry, that kind of thing, sitting in our SUVs, running our air conditioning. Can you guys talk, Dr. White and Joel, a little bit about what can the young people start to do and look at differently in their lives? What can they do to feel like they're really making a part, making a big difference in this ecological movement?
So I think I have to, my wife is sitting right there. She's a kindergarten teacher, and she was telling me today that this week one of the students brought in tadpoles for the class. And, you know, the kids just loved it, watching these tadpoles. You know, they could do it for hours, and they have it. They love nature already. And I think we just need to give more opportunities, you know, and we have great places around here, natural places. You don't have to go far. And so keeping the kids connected to nature, I think, is really important. But, you know, and this is a difficult movie for some younger people to watch. But the messages are there, and that there are little things we can do. We can talk about reducing our waste stream, you know, reusing things, recycling things, planting gardens. All of these things, they help. They make a difference.
I think there's one kid in the room, right? One. And really, the ratio needs to be reversed for this. What I would say is that, he's your nephew, no wonder. you know, one thing that none of the adults in this room will do if they're in their right mind is to get their kids to nag them more about doing the right thing. And the right thing is everything from insulating your home really well, puts less carbon in the air, drive a smaller car, more fuel-efficient car, walk, ride your bike, eat less meat, eat fruits and vegetables in season and buy them locally because you don't have to burn all that carbon to get the food transported to you. There's a lot of things. Quit putting chemicals on your lawn. They end up in the watershed. Other people are going to drink the poison you put in your lawn. They're going to drink it. And all the frogs and fish are going to drink it too. Don't even water your lawn. When you water your lawn, it grows more and you have to mow it more. Do you like mowing your lawn? You're throwing more carbon into the air. We actually bought a no-water fescue developed at University of Nebraska at the Mead Research Station. We tore out our lawn and we put this no-water fescue in. You water it to get it established, then you never water it again. And we've had some real hard droughts since then. It goes a little brown when it's dry out, but when it rains, it greens right up. It's really amazing. And we don't do a thing to our lawn, and we also have clover and dandelions in our lawn, which helps bees. We have to help bees and flies, you know, because we want fruits and vegetables. They pollinate fruits and vegetables. So there's a lot of things we can do. Another thing you can do if you really care about endangered species is become a member of the zoo here. If you live in Lincoln, become a member of the Lincoln Zoo. They breed critically endangered species. Your money goes directly to work to do that. That's a direct pipeline towards endangered species if saving carbon isn't sexy enough for you.
Hi, Joel. My question is more directed at you. How did you start with National Geographic to create the impact in wildlife photography that you have today?
I had parents that were really into nature. They cared a lot about it, and that made me care about it. And I grew up going to the Omaha Zoo and loved it. And my parents provided me with a lot of books back in the Stone Age when we didn't have the internet. I had a lot of nature books, and I got a specific book on the birds, a Time Life book on the birds. You remember that old book? It's got a chapter on extinction. It's got Martha the passenger pigeon in it. And I was really fascinated by that. And so when I went to the Geographic, I hadn't really shot much nature until I got there. And then I realized they would pay me to do stories about the things I cared about. So I just started doing more and more conservation stories there with them. And so far, so good.
I also have a question for Mr. Sartore, and I wanted to know if you can tell us more about PhotoArc and how we can, you know, find pictures and more information about what you're doing.
Sure. Call me Joel. I'm not a doctor. I appreciate you asking that. The photo arc's geared to be spread around. We give all the pictures away free to every institution I work at. Every place that I work gets the pictures for free. And they're intended to be shared. These pictures are intended to go around the world and save species. So the best thing you can do, honestly, is follow us on Instagram and like us on Facebook and all the other things you're supposed to do with social media. Tell people about it and try to get it into the conversation. Louis, when I was hanging out with him filming, he hung out with me three times, a minute each time is what made it up there, I think. He used to say, we don't have to convert everybody. 15 to 20% of the population is usually all it takes to tip an issue forward. So right now, the American public especially is not thinking about the environment at all. You don't hear anything about it in conversations. We really need to tip that forward so that we can start talking about these issues before the skies really, really do bad things to us. No rain, too much rain. We just really need to work on that, and that starts with you guys. You know, if we have a pretty big, healthy crowd here. So if each of you let people know about these issues tonight on social media before you forget about it, we could really start something, right? It's like starting the wave at a big football game. And it's really possible to do, but you have to tell other people that you know that this matters to you. If they respect you, if they're friends with you, they'll come out of the woods a little bit, won't they? And they'll raise their hand and say, it matters to me too. I think that's really a key thing. Social media is really kind of where it's at now. That's where the market is.
All right, my name is Jenna. Hi. And I just kind of wanted to ask, you know, we are promoting things like wind energy. This is something that's really personal to me because I work with the bats, and then I also, my partner works with wind energy. So how do you promote something like wind energy, which is inherently good, different than fossil fuel, different than all of that, and yet you also see the issues with other species declining? How do you choose what to fight for?
That's a good question. So if people don't know the background on wind development and bats in particular, but also birds, raptors, there's been a lot of mortality at wind energy facilities of birds and bats. And I think some of that might have been expected, but not to the level we've seen, especially with bats. Really large numbers of migratory species of bats are killed at these facilities, and there's some evidence that they're attracted to them in some way, where birds might fly by, bats are flying towards them. I think a real positive turn recently was that wind companies, a majority of them, have agreed voluntarily to feather their turbines during times when we expect bats to be flying by those areas, which is a known way to reduce mortality. So they're acknowledging that it's a problem, and they're trying to do something about it. So I think that's a really good first step. I prefer solar energy.
I've got a question about that. I had read that birds striking glass buildings makes the number of birds killed by turbines trivial. Is that true?
True, and cats.
Feral cats
and windows. Yeah,
so that's, I mean,
true.
It's like multiple times.
Multiple
right?
times what wind yeah. turbines do. Yeah.
So I mean, if you got a lot of glass on your house, you put the stickers on the windows to keep birds colliding. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction, right? So everything we put up into the sky or dig down in the ground, it's going to affect something. And you really can go crazy trying to think about all this stuff. It is the path to madness. My staff, who's here tonight, they can tell you that's true. But if you focus in on one thing, at the end of your days, in your declining hours, you can look at yourself in the mirror and smile a little bit, knowing you did what you could. You don't have to save the whole world. Just pick something. Most of you in this room have the ability to make great changes, but you got to focus on one thing and just keep working at that and educating people and never get tired of it, never give up. And at the end, you'll move the needle, but you really do need to do something. It's not enough to do nothing.
Hi, my name is Noel Asher, and I'm a student at Creighton Prep. And I was just wondering, since one of the main things that people look at in cutting back on CO2 emissions is in terms of driving and how it's a huge part of our lives and the only reason we're able to so easily get jobs in a city and make a livable income is because we have these cars that can get us from point A to point B so easily. And Tesla actually has recently released a car that I believe the MSRP is only $35,000. And I was wondering, what are your opinions on what that could do for the market, even if other companies don't necessarily grasp the electric car concept? But, like, do you think it could catch a bit easier than, say, like, hybrid cars, which still use gas and electric combination engine?
Sure. I mean, I went to lunch with Ted Turner's daughter in Atlanta. She's on Defenders of Wildlife board with me. And we ate grass-fed bison, which is good for you, you know. And when we pulled in the parking lot, I was in my little Prius, and she was in her Tesla. And we pulled in underneath the it was a hot day, and the parking lot was shaded by these big flat-top trees. They're beautiful. Well, what they were solar arrays on poles, and she plugged her car in, and her car charged completely while we had our two-hour lunch, and she drove off. So the answer is yeah, but you can't get the electricity to charge your car with coal. It's filthy. You can't do it that way. You have to get your electricity, your charge, from renewable resources. That's key. If you can do that, you can drive around pretty guilt-free, don't you think?
Yeah, and then I don't mean to hog the mic, but as a follow-up question, do you think a lot more people would be compelled to buy these electric cars if you saw more charging stations popping up around the city? Because as it is, you see a gas station that's a block away from your house, and you think, oh, well, if I just drive my car till it's near empty, I can go down and fill up whenever I need. But then someone who has an electric car, they either have to fill up their house, charge up at their house. But if there were more charging stations around the downtown area and spread out, like, say, a charging station at each gas station in the city, do you think that would?
Well, I tell you, I really admire the Turners. It's a pretty high-end restaurant. You think people go in there? Do you think the Turners put out more money charging cars or selling the food in that restaurant? It's a great marketing opportunity, right? They didn't do it for that reason, I'm sure. But if you have a car and you need a charge, are you going to go to a restaurant that has a charging station? You're going to go to a restaurant without a charging station. I think that it's all this stuff. Being green is profitable. It can be a really good thing. But in the long run, I think it's got to be a market solution. Most people are not like you guys. You're all in the choir already, or you wouldn't have sat here after the movie was over. You wouldn't have come down in the first place. The big thing is it going to compete in the marketplace? At $35,000, that's easier than $70,000, isn't it? And so now it could, if people calculate that they can make it work, or at least have it be a wash compared to what they'd spend on another car and gasoline, could work out. Could that work out real well? That's got to be the thing, though. It's got to be a market solution in this economic world. Anybody up in the hot section up top?
Any efforts in the university system in Nebraska to get the university to divest from fossil fuels?
That's a good question. There was a student organization, Environmental Club. The problem with students is they don't stick around long enough. You know, they started this and they had this idea of divestment, which other schools have done, and they started to get the ball rolling, and then, you know, they graduated, I think. So at current, I don't know of any. If anyone does in here for the university system, for UNO, I don't know if that's on the table right now.
Be kind of nice if a university led the way in forward thinking.
I just wondered what your thoughts are on separating yard waste from our regular trash, or should we throw them all together and create more methane gas?
Compost.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm a big fan of not spending fossil fuel transporting leaves to another place where they can degrade. Why not just let them degrade in your backyard? why burn fossil fuel to move leaves and sticks around? That doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
And you don't necessarily have to move them to a compost bin. As Joel said, you just leave them in your yard, and they will be gone the next after spring. They'll either blow away or decompose.
Along the line of what she was just saying with the methane, even if we don't combine the yard waste with the trash, is that a good thing that at the landfill they can convert that debris to methane and trap that methane and use it to create energy? Doesn't hurt the environment to do it that way.
Right, and we do get a small portion of our energy through OPPD through landfill gas, and it is, the decomposition of those things, trapping the methane given off by the bacteria and using that as power, you're right, instead of letting that methane leak into the atmosphere. That's a win.
Is the world sustainable to... if there's as many people born in the world as there has been since my parents or myself, can the world take care of all these people? I mean, wouldn't a solution be if everybody in the world just stopped having so many kids?
We are at a point right now, and the projections change, but that there is, we do see some leveling off that's coming, it looks like, in 2100 or so, at about, I think, 11 billion people. In the meantime, we are still growing as a nation, and we are consuming more meat as a globe, and that takes a lot of space and a lot of land, as they showed in the film. So we need to change things a little faster. I don't think we can wait until 2100 when we level off. And that might be too many. We're already using more Earths than we have.
One of the things that's really key is to be able to double our food production on the current agricultural footprint. The current acres that are in production for food, we have to double the production in the next 30 years or so. Or what's going to happen is people that are hungry, they're going to go ahead and take all the rest of the trees, all the rest of the forests, all the rest of the prairies. They're just going to strip everything out and the ocean life too to eat. So we really, when people bag on genetically modified crops and Roundup and because they see headlines, man, it's complicated for one, but we really want to know, is it good or bad? Is it a friend or an enemy? We see it in politics now. It's sickening. Life's complicated. So the truth of the matter is, you're going to see more genetically modified crops. We got to have them so we don't strip out the entire surface of the earth to feed ourselves. We have to really, really increase technology in agriculture, or all is lost if we don't do it. So quit spitting the bit on GMOs. That's here to stay, and we got to have it. But it's really key. One of the key things is that you guys are interested. And you're all kind of baptized a little bit tonight by this movie, aren't you? The key is to be interested and to learn and to keep an open mind and to read different viewpoints and make up your own mind on this, and don't let anybody tell you what to think. Not us, not anybody, not pundits you see on television. Keep an open mind and really dig in and learn and try to talk to people yourselves who know the subjects you're most interested in. There's so many echo chambers out there where people just spew things and then listen to whatever comes back to them as if it's a new thought. Well, echo chambers don't really work to advance the problems we're facing, which are pretty monumental coming up. Really, truly, if you take anything away tonight, try to dig into one subject, learn about it on your own, and try to do something about it. Like Laura is a living example of that. Here's a person that's, with the help of lots of other people, of course, but she's a driving force, 5,000 animals a year that would perish without her, that's awesome. That's one person. That's one person doing that, so that's pretty incredible.
We have time for two more questions. We've got one here and one there.
To segue into that, I actually was wondering if Laura could actually talk about locally what we can do here with our animals. Not to put you
this
on the spot.
This is one of my volunteers putting me on the spot. You know, people often ask us, why do we rehabilitate animals? You know, the raccoon, there's millions of raccoons, there's possums everywhere. Why do we do it? And I think that there are a lot of reasons why we do it, but you know, as we were talking to students earlier today, we said, how long did it take for people to drive sharks, different shark species, to the brink of extinction? And I'm not suggesting that the raccoons are the next extinction, but it doesn't take that long when people put their mind to it to cause some really great damage. And so I think that together we need to put value on wildlife and the wild spaces that they need to survive. And as a community, if we do that, we make a difference here. You know, we can't all go to Africa, we can't all go into the oceans and do that work, but we can put value on the things that are important to us in our own community. I also, of course, you can guess as a wildlife rehabilitator what my favorite scene of the movie is. Of course, am I too loud?
No, your mic's not out. I'll switch you.
Can you hear me? Did I just give you a whole, like a whole philosophical rant and you couldn't hear me at all?
Nope,
my favorite part of the movie, of course, was when he swims down and saves that ray, right? He probably didn't, you know, she might have lived otherwise. But a lot of times we forget that animals do have pain and they have connections. He made a connection with that animal, and I think there are a lot of our volunteers in the audience tonight, and they know that we can make that connection as well. These lives are important. We can put them on a scale of value where we want to put them, but they're important. And I just have to say that the Omaha community has been so good about supporting Nebraska Wildlife Rehab. It really is a community that I want to live in when we start to value those things. Did that answer your question, Jenna? All right, thank you.
My question is more directed towards Dr. White. Do you know if there's any programs either through UNO or UNL or any of the surrounding universities that's focusing on the amphibian crisis and or how close they are to figuring out something to kill the fungus that doesn't kill the frog?
So Joel might know about this too, because I know that the zoo has a program, right? And they're working to identify. And I know there's been some work with professors at Kearney too, where they've identified chytrid fungus in some of the local amphibian populations there. But I think the zoo's leading that charge in the state.
They figured out how to cure the fungus in captive populations, but of course the real problem is out in the wild, because zoos can't house two terrible. Zoos are arcs. They are holding a lot of species that would be extinct by now, so they do a tremendous job. But in terms of out in the wild, this is a conundrum. But we could leave the session tonight on a happy note, and that is, I went to Panama with Brian Gratwick of the Smithsonian, and I mentioned this thing, 50% of all amphibians in the next 20, 30 years. That's what's been bandied about, right? And he says, well, in Panama, where chytrid fungus has really, really driven a lot of species downward, we're predicting more like 10 to 15% extinction. We think that's where it may end up, because we're seeing some resistance in a few animals sometimes, and those animals pass that on to their young, and they go ahead and exploit the new vacant ecosystem, vacant for frogs. So it may not be as bad as we think, and something else will rush in and take its place no matter what. So thank you, guys.
This go on chytrid either. There is some research that suggests that chytrid is a naturally occurring fungus in the wild, and that the reason we are seeing amphibians succumb to it at such a high rate is because of the things that we're doing to them. So they're having to deal with more than they've ever had to deal with before in terms of pesticides, habitat loss. You know, amphibians react very poorly to pesticides that we put in the environment. And so, you know, this is another man-made problem. And we're seeing great strides in a cure in captivity and other sorts of research. But it's something that we need to keep an eye on, because it's not something we just see with amphibians. We see it with a lot of other wildlife, that they are getting ill because of other pressures from diseases that occur naturally in the wild. Yeah.
But it's not all bad. Thank you.